Marlon, what were the shows that you've done in New York? Name one or two for me.
I was in Canada with Catherine Cornell.
Yes.
And I was in Eagle Rampant with Tallulah Bankhead.
Yes.
And,
I remember Mama.
With Sophie Rosenstein.
Not quite.
And,
Old Truck Line Cafe.
Oh, yeah. Truck Line Cafe.
Well, that's good enough. Now, will you turn your head for us?
Sure.
Now around the other way. Now all the way around. Thank you, and stay there.
Mr. Brando, those of us who know you only by what we read about you have heard that you're a self-centered person. Have you always felt this way about equality and more freedom for the Negroes?
Well, I was brought up in a community where there were no Negroes. There were a few who I had as friends, and it was never taught in my home. I think one of the important things that we have to realize is that hatred is traditional. Amongst some tribes of American Indians, there was traditional warfare between two tribes. In New Guinea, there are traditional wars that go on. Some of the wars we've had in Western Europe have been almost traditional wars. The Germans and the French and the English have, I think, perhaps followed that pattern. And when hatred is taught to children, they learn it very young, and it becomes part of the family standard that they adhere to later in life. And I think all the people today who have discriminated in that fashion are now faced with some very special kinds of reconsideration, very unusual forces that are causing people to take second looks at what tradition has taught them.
Who of your colleagues in Hollywood feel the same as you do?
There's a list as long as my arm. I couldn't possibly name it. There are many people who are vastly interested, and they were working under heavy schedules. They couldn't be here, but they would be here today, and they send their good graces and their hopes and their very best to this movement.
Mr. Brando, isn't this activity of yours here liable to backfire at the box office?
Well, it's whether it backfires or not, it's incidental to the cause. I think that we feel, and many people of goodwill, many more than is generally thought of, are interested in bringing this unfortunate situation of the Negro and all other oppressed groups, such as the Filipino, the Jew, the Mexican, the Chinese, the Japanese, to a very abrupt end. I think that we will go as far as we can go as actors. There is, I heard a plan discussed today, which I certainly would like to participate in, which would allow that our films be banned in theaters in the South, in the North, wherever there's discrimination in seating.
Thank you, Mr. Brando.
Thank you. This is a picture, a portrait of my mom when she was about, how old was she, Pop?
40.
About 40. And she was, I was just pausing because it's an odd thing. The night of the award was the anniversary of my mom passing away. So it's been kind of a lot of mixed feelings, and it's odd that it should, you know, we bring it up now. Mm. But she was a marvelous person. For instance, she dressed up a pet goose we had for Santa Claus. She made a Santa Claus out of it and made a little red costume for it and a beard and everything. And she was a very inventive and artistic woman, and I'm Mr. Brando.
Speaking of rhythms, this young man is famous in Hollywood not only for his acting, but also for his hobby. Between takes, Marlon Brando is the main attraction on this set. So, as the camera crew gets ready for the next scene, let's drop in on Brando, the cat with the bongo beat.
Marlon, you're really getting some tough sounds from the congas there, boy.
Well, I see by your words you're down on the scene yourself.
Well, Cat, I'm in there pitching all the time and very observant.
Well, crazy.
But now tell me, well, when did you get this, develop this wonderful affection for drums and drumming?
Well, I'll tell you, Ed, it's a funny thing. Ever since I was a kid, I've always been fascinated by rhythm. And I remember when I was years ago, when I was living on the farm, I used to love to listen to the donkey engine. There used to be a donkey engine for the water pump. And I used to love to listen to that thing pulsate. And it just had something to say to me and had an appeal for me. I mean, some people are drawn to the tone and others to color and form. And I think that is...
Well, how does a donkey engine sound? I've never heard a donkey engine.
Well, it's... It goes, it's an eccentric kind of, I mean, it's off rhythm. It goes,
And you got the message.
Yeah, if it doesn't appeal your ear, then of course it seems like kind of senseless. But I also, I'll tell you another thing. I used to love to ride on trains. When I'd ride on trains, I used to love to stand in the vestibule of the car and listen to the rails. As a matter of fact, apropos of that, I can tell you a funny story. Sometimes when I come out here on the Super Chief, I'll be passing to the dining car or something, and I'll pass through the vestibule, and I'll stop to listen to the rails, and I'll just spend a minute there listening to the spadoodly dits, spadoodly dats, spadoodly dits, spadoodly doodly doo doo doo, you know. And I'll be there kind of lost in the feeling of the rhythm, and a passenger will pass through the vestibule and do, you know, the classic double take. And I'll immediately pretend that I have some business there, which causes a kind of a flimsy cover-up. But I often get, you know, caught like that. It's kind of silly. But, of course, the story always gets out that if they know me, if they recognize me, that they saw Marlon Brando in red underwear in between the vestibule of the train, and he was chasing a chicken around and trying to bite the tail feathers out. You know, it always gets ridiculous.
Yeah, well, that explains a lot of those Daffy legends that grew up about you, because actually I was a little apprehensive when I first came out here on the Guys and Dolls set, because I'd never met you before. Often admired you on the stage and screen. I didn't know exactly what sort of a person you were. At lunch, Marlon, I was very struck by your vast knowledge of comedians like Jackie Gleason, Sid Caesar, Wally Cox, the late Willie Howard. Now, when you're observing them, are you conscious that there's a very close kinship between the art of the comic and the art of the dramatic star?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I think that there is more than a direct correlation between the two. I think that they are identically congruent. Well, it's difficult to be succinct about it in a brief moment, but I'll try to explain myself. For instance, I feel that both of them must draw on reality and have reality as a base, otherwise they'd simply lose any effectiveness that they might have. Not any, but they get the greatest degree of effectiveness from the directness with which they relate to reality. For instance, I'll give you an example. If a man, a father, suddenly looks out and he sees his child in the distance having an avalanche of stones come over him, then his feeling of horror and apprehension and fear and anxiety about this situation has to be real. He has to really feel it. There are a few actors who are able to emulate it without feeling it, but those are very few. And I don't know whether I've ever seen one or not. But, you see, it has to be real because the audience is identifying with him. And if the audience cannot believe him, then he loses, he's lost. Now, in the same way, a comedian, when a custard pie, is coming at him, and it's about to visit his face very shortly, he has to really believe, he has to be afraid, and he has to transmit that fear to the audience, even in exaggerated terms, no matter what mug he makes, he has to have some feeling of fear, because if he's just a plain mug, when I mean mug, a grimace, it doesn't mean anything. He has to have something to support it.
Well, then the comics really are heeding Hamlet's advice. Hold the mirror up to nature.
Yes, I think they are. The only difference being that the mirror, in this case, is convex.
Well, I'm very anxious for you. I know you haven't seen all of the footage that's been shot on Guys and Dolls, but your light comedy performance in Guys and Dolls is really terrific, Marlon.
Well, I hope so. I'm very anxious to see it. As a matter of fact, I'm dying to see it. Because I've never played a part. I was anxious to play this part because it demanded a little something from me that, well, more than a little something. It demanded a style of playing that I never played in before, and I hope it comes off well.
Well, actually, all of these things have come to pass, as you'll see, but you know, I do want to tell you how much I've enjoyed being here on the set with you and Gene and Joe Mankiewicz and Michael Kidd and Sam Goldin and all of you. But I think my greatest kick, actually, is finding in you just the same likable, decent, normal guy that I always thought you were just from watching your performance on the screen.
Well, that means more to me than anything else you might say, and I appreciate that. Thank you.